Erevan O'Neill, Clonakilty Irish whiskey for my favourite Irish. Bolcha Arash, welcome back to the bar. I've got a Corkman with me today. Erevan, great to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, no, it's we've been working on this for a while to get you to the bar, and here you are. So we have a Corkman and a Cork whiskey.
It's pretty shameful. It took a while to get me to a bar as an Irishman to start with.
So first things first, you probably have one of the most unusual names that I've come across. You know, it's not a traditional Irish name, so to speak. So Erevan, E-R-E-V-A-N, lots of vowels in there for the vowel lovers. Where'd it come from?
Yeah, well, it's it's an old Irish name, and like most Irish things, there's a long, sad story, but the abbreviated version is, it's an anglicized version of Erevoin,
okay,
also known as Erewine, and he was the first High King of Ireland, and he came up the Milesian line. There were blow-ins from the north of Spain, and the brothers fought each other, and eventually Erevoin had this stone of destiny, the Lea Fall, and he became the first High King. But it was actually the derivation of Erevan came from Cape Clear, the island off the southwest of Ireland. And it was a name my father had found when he was fishing, I believe.
Okay.
And he liked the sound
of
it. Yeah, and he didn't know the story behind it. He got the story from a granduncle of mine. He's a historian, and he told him the stories of the Milesians. But
so how was it going to school with an unusual name like that? Was it?
Well, in Ireland, people bastardize your name, whatever it is.
yeah.
Actually, I found in America, Americans get my name better than the Irish do.
Okay.
So I'll tell someone in Ireland, my name is Erevan. Right, Erwin, gotcha.
Erwin.
No problem. Yeah, Erwin is usually what it is, because I think that's actually another anglicized version of Erewine.
Okay.
So, but growing up, it was fine. It was always one that people stumbled over. And it's great for me because I'm terrible with people's names in the first place. And it gives me a good excuse because they'll never know my name. So I can always be the one that'll be.
I would have thought it would have been the opposite with a name so unusual that it would stick with people.
But it does, but they always have to come back and ask again, how do you pronounce it?
Yeah.
And
you're one of how many kids?
There are three in my family. I have a sister and a brother.
Did they have equally historical names?
Nope, James and Kelly. James is an older brother, and Kelly's a younger sister. And we're all scattered. Kelly recently returned from Perth.
Okay.
And she's living at home.
Perth in Western Australia.
Western Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where my brother James is.
Okay.
And I'm obviously here in California.
And I know that you got to spend some time back in, and we should let people know that home, of course, is Cork, but actually, more specifically, West Cork.
West Cork, a completely different county.
It is.
And West, even more so than Clonakilty is. So we are 2 hours west of Cork City, a little fishing village called Castletown Bear in the Beira Peninsula. The best place in the world to grow up as a kid, and the best place in the world to visit. If you're able to live there, it's a wonderful place to live, but it's isolated.
Okay.
Castletown Nowhere was where my college buddies called it, and it's out there, but it's a wonderful place to live. And being in West Cork, it's almost more of a state of mind than a place, like which represents West Cork in general.
So how does that fit in with, because growing up we used to joke that, you know, Cork was the Republic of Cork. Is West Cork its own entity beyond that?
Cork is split into its competing individual internal republics, and West Cork is completely different from East Cork and Cork City. And but ultimately, once you're in Cork, you're in Cork.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's all that matters.
It's a Cork frame of mind. And folks won't know this, but you're a neighbour of ours here, lived just down the hill. I've known of you longer than I've known you. Did some work with your in-laws way back when.
That's
with,
right.
With Albert and Kim. I did a little bit of consultancy work with them back in the day, and knew of you because they'd said their daughter had married a Corkman. You were living in San Francisco at that time, but you're now up here in Napa. So got out of the big smoke to come up here?
Yes, typical immigrant story to this part of the world. Just drawn to San Francisco and found it and said, hey, that's it for me. I'm here now. And why would I want to live anywhere else? And it's all well and good when you're single and young. But as life goes on, kids come along and the dynamic changes. And moving to Napa has been the best thing we ever did, honestly. Love it here in Napa. I still have one foot in the city. Yeah. My business is in the city. So we started, we came out, it was 2003 when I first came out, and 2005 by the time I figured out how to come out here legally. So, but ever since then, it's been no looking back, and San Francisco, Napa, it's all the yeah. same to me.
And you have you say, one foot in the city, so you're a structural engineer.
That's
by,
correct.
By trade, you have your own business,
yep.
which is having mine here in California. Being self-employed is obviously it's a badge of honor. It's a state in which being a business owner can be challenging, for many reasons. But yeah, you're a structural engineer, and you're proudly wearing your logoed wear, which we'll take a picture of. So, yeah, you've worked on some fun projects.
Yeah, as my father-in-law says, I'm an entrepreneur, which means I get stuck in everything, every part of the business. For me, I was always going to be the type of person that would do my own thing. And I came out here, worked for a few years. As soon as I got my license, I turned the box upside down. So the year I got my license, a year after that, we got pregnant with our first kid, Maya. And that was 11 years ago, and I quit the company I was working with, started One Design literally the same month Maya was born, and there's been no looking back ever since.
Some people would call you crazy for doing something like that.
Well, if I grew up in a place like this, I'm crazy to begin with, so I've been told I've been crazy for a long time. So, but yes, definitely a lot of craziness there, but being in San Francisco, being an engineer, a structural engineer, and dabbling in a bit of architecture as well.
Okay.
It was easy. It was a natural transition. There's a great Irish community in San Francisco, and they pulled me up, and I'm ever so thankful for everything that they've enabled me to build. And I'm happy to celebrate 10 years in business as of last year and still going. So it's been a heck of a ride.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been up and down, but always more ups than downs. And I'm just delighted I've been given the opportunities that San Francisco and California has given me. So it's been wonderful. I'm very thankful for it.
And you mentioned the Irish community there. I know you and I have talked about the Irish Cultural Centre there in the Sloat Avenue area. They're looking to make some significant changes and upgrades there, and they seem to be moving along with it.
They are. They're moving along at a great pace, actually. Good. Yeah. It's a very bold plan, and it's a very ambitious plan, and it's a very exciting plan. So what they've proposed there is a huge overhaul of the property. They've got the planning department on board.
Good.
I was Mr. Skeptical at the start, telling them, I was like, I don't know if planning's going to sign off on this, and... Because my business is planning and getting permits and entitlements, and I know enough to be dangerous, as they say. So, but they said, no, they had it all sewn up. It's all good, ready to go. And I think it'll probably be a few years before the entitlements come through. But
okay.
But it's representative of where the Irish community is right now in San Francisco, and that things need to be shaken up a little bit. And the Irish community is not what it used to be for immigrants coming out nowadays. But it is still in a very important part for the diaspora here in San Francisco, particularly when you're coming out. I mean, it's different now. It's not like you go out there looking for a job like you would have 20 years ago. And even when I came, I was kind of on the cusp. Like, we would have gone out there, but not as often as...
Well, and you say
before.
Gone out there. The place is out there.
It is out there. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, we drove by it a couple of times when we went to play around the golf down there at Harding Park. You know, it's down there in the foggy southern
it
reaches.
Is. Yeah. So it's an exciting new rebranding of what they're offering. Yeah.
Great. So. Great. So whiskey, we could chat probably all night as we have done in the past. So I'm going to pour some whiskey in your glass and mine. We both had birthdays with zeros in them through the pandemic. And we would stand our few feet apart in the neighborhood and chat. And I told you that I had a five in front of my zero. And you dropped by a bottle of Jameson as a birthday gift from me a couple of years back. And I returned the favor this year because you had a birthday with a four in front of your zero. Mm-hmm. So, and I, as people know, Redbreast was my gateway into this part of the journey. So we've drunk way too much Redbreast. And I hadn't drunk Jameson for a long time. We ran out of Redbreast one night. I cracked that bottle of Jameson, and I have to say I was very surprised and taken by, for such a, you know, a commercial and well-distributed whiskey, how great it was. So thank you for the 50th birthday present, which got me back drinking Jameson again. So
thank you.
So West Cork, I've got a bottle of West Cork here on the shelf as well, which is great because it has a map on it.
Yeah.
Which, and you said, you know, you're kind of in your own republic out there, but so whereabouts is home on this bottle?
So on this bottle here, the southwest of Ireland, this is the Beira Peninsula, and Castletown Beira is right out there.
Okay.
And it's about almost an hour, it's probably a good solid hour west of Skibbereen where this is made.
Okay.
And
from Clonakilty?
Skibbereen is probably about 10 or 15 minutes from Clonakilty.
Okay.
At least the last time I drove there. Who knows now, the roads might be better. But Skibbereen's a good 45 minutes from west of Cork City.
Okay.
So it's out there. And I, like, the first time I'd seen West Cork whiskey was actually in Whole Foods here in Napa. Yeah. I was like, what the heck is this doing here? And then I see these little name places, like there's all these little tiny townlands like Rodine and Drom and all these little places, and it's something I want to learn more about as part of the next step in my whiskey journey.
Whiskey journey, yeah.
So
I think it's great that we, you know, here is a distillery localish to where you grew up. Like this, I've got a bottle of Fir Cullen here from Powerscourt, which is local to where I grew up. You know, this didn't happen when we were growing up. There was no distilleries down the road. So I'm loving this new renaissance in Irish whiskey.
100%, yeah. Like you said there, it's like, what is there, more than 51?
It's, yeah, just over 50 now.
Distilleries now, yeah. And a couple of years ago, it was like three or four in a short period of time.
That's, yeah, no, it's
really great.
Yeah, it is. So let's put that back on the shelf. I've poured some of your favorite Irish here, which is from the Scully family in Clonakilty. Clonakilty was historically better known for its pudding.
Yeah, it's true.
It's black and white pudding. I haven't been to Clonakilty for an awful long time. Have you been there and travelled recently?
Last time I was in Clonakilty was probably about 10 years ago, I'd say, just driving through. But yeah, it's a wonderful town. It's probably changed, obviously, like everywhere else. But it's my memories of Clonakilty. It's a great town, a small town, yet a big town in the scene of West Cork. And there's a great little pub down there called De Barra's Pub. And we'd have many a good night down there that we would have, when we were in college years, we would have taken a day trip down to
Clonakilty.
Yeah. And a lot of happy memories. Great place. Lovely part of the world. Very pretty. People very friendly. All football rivalries aside, you know, people still very friendly to Beira folk.
Okay.
Even though we'd be competitors of theirs.
in the Cork Championship.
In the Cork Championship. And it's all football down there. There's no hurling. Okay. Or very little hurling anyway. So.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Let's, we should slauncha.
Slauncha.
Yeah. It's lovely to have a Cork man and a Cork whiskey at the bar. Yeah, lovely. It's a lovely, attractive nose on this one.
Oh, yeah, it's lovely, smooth.
So, from what I know about this one, it's a grain whiskey. So, made from predominantly corn. That's, and if I'm wrong, happy to be corrected. But what they've been doing a great job of is their finishing. They finish it in all these fun different barrels. And this one's finished in a Bordeaux cask barrel. So, yeah, adds a little bit of extra character to it. So, and weighs in, you know, you and I talked before about, you know, the alcohol front. This one weighs in at 43 and a bit, 43.6. And in my opinion, it just gives the flavors a little lift, just that extra little bit of alcohol. But
And you were able to purchase that here locally?
Yeah, I bought this up in Oregon.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, you and I have shared some whiskies, and this is one that you really fell for.
Yeah.
So, I know that Sean Scully from the family lives up in Portland, so they have big distribution up there. They're big up in Oregon. I'm not sure which other states they're strong in. They are here in California, but you won't see them in every store mm-hmm. like you do up in Oregon. So yeah, lovely nose, just lovely and attractive.
Yeah, it's lovely and smooth and sweet. For me, as a novice at this and a gateway whiskey, this is a great early novice whiskey, I think, for someone with a sweet tooth.
So you've told me, as we've talked over the last, you know, weeks and months and years, that you like to have your whiskey with some chocolate.
Yes, actually. I'm slightly embarrassed to say.
You shouldn't be.
I find that the flavor of both get enhanced, the chocolate and raisins. It brings the flavor out in raisins, the really sticky, caramelly kind of texture and everything. A little bit of popcorn, actually. And
whiskey and popcorn.
Walnuts and raisins, though. That's my kind of go-to little snack while I'm watching TV. And
so here's a technical question for you on the chocolate front. So would you chew, bite, and swallow the chocolate so there's still some of it in your mouth and then have the whiskey? Or would you have it in your mouth when you're sipping the whiskey?
I have it in the mouth when I'm sipping the whiskey.
Okay.
Yeah, swirl it around. And
interesting.
Yeah, it's beautiful, delicious.
So I'm working on a chocolate whiskey project, and when I get to the far end of it, we'll have some fun.
Yeah,
some whiskey and chocolate.
And different, I'm not a black chocolate or a dark chocolate fan, but with whiskey, it's amazing. I love it. So it's opened up new little avenues. And
that's lovely. Goodness, isn't it? Smooth.
Yeah, it's delicious. It's not too big that it's filling your nose or anything like that, but you know it's there.
Soft. I think it's lovely and soft in the mouth.
Yeah.
I'm going to add a couple of drops. Not that I need to, because I'm not sure if you want to take a couple of drops. Just see if it softens up and changes the flavor a little. So from everything I've read, obviously, the Scully family they're going to be releasing their own whiskies very soon. I believe that this is ultimately going to be discontinued here in the States.
Oh.
So you don't know this yet, but you'll be taking this bottle home with you to enjoy. And
reluctantly.
I'll twist the other arm. So I know we were both back on the old sod this summer. You got to spend more time than me there. You were back for a bit.
Almost a month, yeah. And true to Irish form, it lashed rain for the first 5 days solid, and there was two 4-year-olds and a 6-year-old and a 10-year-old running around the place in the pouring rain. And but after that, Ireland shone for us. You know, we've been really lucky generally. Is like I said before, there's no better place in the world to visit. And when you go back in summertime, to be able to go out and have a game of golf, a round of golf after dinner, it's wonderful. You know?
Oh, that because it's brighter later.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I know. I remember that growing up. You'd be still out at 10 o'clock in mid-June into July.
Yeah, and in West Cork, we're proud of the fact that we're right at the edge of the one-hour time zone. We really should be in a different time zone to Greenwich Mean Time.
Should have your own time zone.
Yeah, we should. Yeah, definitely our own.
And you mentioned a number of kids' ages there. I think you were back there with the cousins from Western Australia.
Yeah, so there was Australian accents. There was California accents running around. Rodeen, in fact, one of the tiny little townlands there that's mentioned in the label of West Cork. So, yeah, it's wonderful to get back to to see family and just to have the kids run around in the freedom. Just to, we have a small little farm there, and to be able to go out and say, go out now and run around for yourself and knock your yayas out. And there's while we're sitting back at the house, so it's great. And we make a point of it to try and go back every year. Obviously, with the pandemic, it was very hard. Yeah. That was the first trip back in a couple of years.
Yeah.
So, but every summer we try and go back and go back for at least 3 weeks.
And good on the rest of the family for being there as well, and the cousins connecting, because it's a long way from here to Western Australia.
It sure is. Yeah. So, and it's one thing getting to Ireland; it's another thing getting to West Cork. So. But
the roads are better than when we grew up.
Certainly, yeah. It used to be a 7-hour drive to Dublin when I was
really
young. Yeah. Halfway point was Fermoy, and that's now a 3.5-hour drive. Depends on how much you're speeding, but it's 4 hours to Dublin from Castletonmere now.
Really?
So
that's a massive difference.
Huge
isn't
difference.
It?
Yeah.
Now things have definitely changed. Obviously, you know, infrastructurally. You know, things have changed. We talked about whiskey changing as well. It's goodness.
Yeah, it's beautiful whiskey. Very, very easy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can.
This is this
get a lot of different flavors. There's a little vanilla, a little cherry, and it's.
Yeah, you're right on the cherry front. There's a dried cherry character in there. This won't last long when it gets down the hill.
No.
Good. So, as you know, we were just back in Ireland as well this summer, and I caught up with the lads that I grew up with. We had a fun weekend in The Hague in the Netherlands, and talked about many things. One of the things we talked about was poutine, because I told them that, you know, we now have legal poutine in Ireland. Here we are taking out more bottles on the bar, but, you know, we got Mad March Hair here, and we've got some Glendalough Mountain Strength. So I hadn't realised how every house has a poutine story. You know, I know where my folks used to acquire, at least I think I know where they used to acquire it from back in the day, and I know where it was stored in you know, in the cupboards in the kitchen. You've got some poutine stories to tell.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, every house has one, and growing up on a farm, there's a lot more uses for poutine than there would be in a Dublin and South Dublin house. One of the main uses that I've ever seen my dad use, I think he used to take a tipple every now and again, but it was for the animals.
Put it on
if there was an animal that had a sore wound or something like that, he'd put it on it.
Okay.
And whenever a cow calved, it was a couple of drops into the straw as well, and to give the cow a little bit of a pep as she was recovering. But it was I found out where he was getting it from.
Okay.
And we dibbled a little bit in it ourselves as young fellas, but it's back then there was no regulation like there is now, and it's
so you were know what you're getting. At a young age you were showing your entrepreneurial spirit.
Well, yeah. The gentleman that he's no longer with us, so I feel a little safer to say this. But he was obviously making it illegally at the time, and we, being young fellas that were up to no good, knew where he was making it and where he was stashing it. So, as young fellas would, when my buddy would come up and we'd go on a little hike down to the river, found it. And
the truth's coming out now.
We, shall we say, we had a lot of good times in that. We knew he couldn't say anything about it. So it was almost a victimless crime as far as we were concerned. So we filled his bottles up with water, emptied out the poutine into our own bottles, and took off with it and sold it to a lot of good punters in the area for the next, I'd say it must have been about 5 years later, we still had some poutine.
Really?
And we were selling it. But it paid for a lot of my misspent youth. But but you know, it's like anything alcohol related. You know, it's dangerous stuff in the wrong hands. And you know, we were lucky enough. We did some silly things, but you know,
these are obviously the days before Facebook and Instagram and mobile phones.
Thankfully,
which,
yes.
A lot of us are grateful for.
Yeah, I mean, I look at poor Maya. How is she going to get away with anything now? We know where she is at all times from her location.
She's not going to be down the creek here stealing someone's stash of moonshine.
No, but I hear there's a good adventure to be had in this creek now. There's a drain pipe that goes all the way up to Bumen that our neighbour used to climb in when he was 10.
Okay.
Yeah, half a mile up the road in a drain pipe, a four foot diameter.
At least
you'll
know where she is.
But at least I'll know where to find her, yeah, because there won't be reception in the drain pipe, so I can go look anyway. No, nowhere to look.
Right. We should wrap up. So I'll raise a
thank
glass.
Thank you. Finished mine already.
Well, we'll say sláinte anyway to your health. And we'll keep sipping, and we will see you next time.
Thank you.
Well done. Yeah, great story. Great stories.
You might have to edit it out in case there's any incriminating evidence, but
the man's dead. There's no, unless his family come looking for you for stolen putchine back in the day. So